Welcome to POTUS 2016, where we call the presidential horse race and pour cold hard facts on the overheated campaign rhetoric. I'm Brian Lehrer. Some weeks, it seems like Donald Trump would rather lead the news than lead the nation, rather rile up his base than widen his appeal. The very day after delivering a prepared economic address designed to better align him with the GOP mainstream came this.
Hillary wants to essentially abolish the Second Amendment. By the way, and if she gets to pick her judges, nothing you can do, folks. Although the Second Amendment people, maybe there is, I don't know. But
oblique language for sure, but it sounded like Trump had off the cuff escalated from lock her up to shoot her down. Trump later claimed he just meant gun rights supporters should vote as a block. The problem with that explanation was that his suggestion, if you listen to it, was how to stop Hillary after all the voting when she would be president. But this is not a year of logic. Also at the top of the campaign news this week, and this occurred before those inflammatory remarks, 50 top Republican national security experts abandoned Trump, fearing a man who hadn't bothered to learn, for example, what the nuclear triad is. Trump dismissed these defectors as the old guard who led us into Iraq. And indeed, there are hawkish neocons on the list. One left-leaning wag we know called this defection of the 50 rats jumping off a sinking rat. In a few minutes, we'll discuss the state of the GOP, plus the role of the Hispanic electorate. And later in our evidence-based politics segment, we'll examine a study that predicts the presidency will be decided by voters in a few specific counties within just 10 swing states. With all that in the mind, saddle up. Yes, time for the horse race. General election polling continues to favor Hillary Clinton 2 weeks after her party's convention. According to Real Clear Politics polling averages, Hillary Clinton, the blue line, now leads Trump by about 8 points in a two-way race. Clinton is still up 7 points over Trump in polling that includes third-party candidates, Libertarian Gary Johnson and the Green Party's Jill Stein. While Clinton appears to have received a sustained bounce following her nomination, she has also been benefiting from an opponent who just can't seem to get out of his own way. Refusing to stick to a script may have worked wonders for Trump in separating himself from more than a dozen Republican opponents during the primaries. Trump's off-the-cuff remarks, since formally accepting the nomination, seem to be working against him. Why? According to a July Pew survey taken before Trump's Second Amendment remarks, voters said that their conversations about the election have already been, by a margin of about 2-1, more about the candidates' personalities and comments and not about specific issues or policy positions. This is not the best news for a candidate considered to be lacking in temperament in the eyes of two-thirds of registered voters. Trump's gaffes are also causing Americans to consider switching parties. Monday's Monmouth University poll of registered Democrats, Republicans, and Independents showed a dramatic shift away from people identifying as Republicans toward Democrats, even more so toward Independents. And Trump's troubles do not end there. He is still performing badly along gender and racial lines. Among women, who will comprise more than half the electorate in November, Trump is at a 27-point disadvantage now, according to last week's Franklin and Marshall College poll. And another group often targeted by Trump's barbed rhetoric is also poised to be a huge spoiler for the candidate. According to the political website The Hill, Hispanic Americans have been registering to vote in droves. About 2 million more Hispanic Americans could be voting in 2016 than in 2012. But of course, Trump keeps repeating that the election is rigged against him anyway. All right, time to think about all this with our guests. Joining us, attorney Raul Reyes. He's on USA Today's Board of Contributors and writes frequently on issues affecting the Latino community. And with us as well, Julio Ricardo Varela. He is political editor for Futuro Media, contributes to public radio's Latino USA, and founded LatinoRebels.com. Welcome to both of you.
Thank you. Pleasure.
And first, I have to ask what you make of Trump's Second Amendment comments.
Oh, this is just another, you know, it's like the pattern of Trump: say something outrageous, then have everyone just jump at it for 24 hours, and then go on a, you know, media-friendly show like Sean Hannity and sort of get the leading question of like, did you really mean that? Didn't you mean this was a, and just kind of laugh it off. I said this, you know, on our In the Thick podcast that we do with Maria Hinojosa, that, you know, his base will love it. He'll play himself as the victim. The media's rigged, you know, they're out to get me. So within his base, like, I don't see much, like, this is sort of like, you know, candy for them, you know? And what's really interesting in that clip is that man in the back who kind of was like, what did he just say?
And, you know, I do actually wonder, Raul, whether these things are because he has no edit switch on his brain and his mouth, or is this actually a strategy? And I mean this, I mean the thing against the Khan family, because he thinks that it's a turnout election. And if he gets every last possible person who could be attracted by this kind of comment, he's got a better chance of winning than appealing to swing voters.
Maybe. I mean, for some reason, he does not seem to have processed the fact that the general election is radically different from the primaries, because he's still going after possibly every single vote. But as Julio said, within his the group that's already his base. Now, and every week we see different comments, we hear more outrageous things. He's certainly not trying to do anything with Latinos. That's almost, he's giving it up. But these comments were particularly ill-timed about, with a joking reference to gun control, because, you know, just a month or so ago, Latinos, when there was the shooting in Orlando targeting LGBT community and Latinos, that's a very sensitive issue with Latinos.
And the problem is it only takes one crazy to be triggered, so to speak, by something like this, even if he means it as some kind of sarcastic joke. And when it's coupled with him saying the election might be rigged, if he's out there after an election of Hillary Clinton saying it's rigged, and then people have these kinds of comments, oh, maybe the Second Amendment people will do something about it, he may mean it as a joke, but that one person who might go off, that's all it takes.
In that sense, it's extraordinarily reckless that he would even joke about something when the whole country has been concerned with mass shootings and with, you know, threats of individuals becoming radicalized. It's just absolutely outrageous. But I think we're at a danger of reaching a point within the nation, as you touched on, that he says so many outrageous things. He does so many outrageous acts that we're becoming, in a sense, desensitized. Because I often see Trump on other networks, not just Fox, where I'm surprised that he doesn't receive strong follow-up questions or more pushbacks on his remarks. And I think some of the mainstream networks are so worried about losing access to Mr. Trump that they will have him on and sort of hold back.
What do you make of the polls of Latino voters that don't show like a 0% support rate for Trump, which you're laughing, but African-American, have you seen the polls of African-Americans? It's 0%. It's 1%, right? And among Latinos in a Quinnipiac poll in June, a third, 33%. Right. Then a New York Times poll had 26%. Right. The next few weeks, which is what Romney had, 27. So he's doing no worse than Romney now. I guess in the latest one that I saw, he's down to about 20%. But that's still one in five Latinos.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to get geeky on you, Brian, because this is what I love about these polls. You really have to look at the poll. Like the Quinnipiac poll, when it really comes down to it, and I've written about this, I don't have it in front of me, but like 140 plus Latinos were interviewed, and of which, you know, so basically, I know Latino Rebels, the headline of like 50 Latinos chose Trump. So I think like you have
the sample size was so small.
It's so small, so you have to look at other polls. Like for example, the Univision poll, which Washington Post, which I believe had, you know, one close to 2,000, and that's like in the teens. Telemundo, NBC News, Wall Street Journal, also in the teens. Other like outside outlier polls like Florida International University that Latino USA has been sort of tracking, it's like a tracking poll online, that it's all in Spanish. So and so that's, you know, Trump hasn't gotten as high as 17%. Mm-hmm. So yeah, but the other polls that are being talked about, yeah, but you know, 27, you know, George Bush got 40% of the Latino vote. Like my Latino.
He was for comprehensive.
Yeah, my Latino conservative friends to this day are like longing for the days of 2004.
Raul, this is from Pew. Mm-hmm. Among Hispanics, those who are English dominant less unified in support for Clinton if people can't see the print on their screens. Interpret this for us.
Well, two things. First of all, you know, I totally get your point about the Latino support for Trump, and agreed. The Quinnipiac poll in particular tends to be an outlier because they only use landlines. So many Latinos are cell phone only. But I think when you look at our communities, people forget that we are a very diverse electorate. So just like you see other Americans who support Trump in the face of all types of rhetoric, really the same goes for Latinos. When you look at these numbers from Pew, and Pew along with Latino Decisions is very reputable with their polling and their numbers, again, it shows a breakdown, especially along demographic lines in terms of support for Hillary Clinton. I believe the average, the median age for Latinos is 27. So when Hillary Clinton is giving her convention speech, talking about registering voters in South Texas in the 70s, that's before most Latinos were born. There's a whole generation that was not alive, that were not adults when Prop 187 passed in California back in 1994. So we see a generational split with Clinton that way. And the fact is, when I talk to Trump supporters, Latino Trump supporters, excuse me, and they do exist, it's interesting because some of the things that they say, the reasons that they give as being behind their support to Trump is pretty much, I guess, what other Americans would say. They say he talks tough. They like his, I guess, aspirational message, where they say he represents success. He's a strong businessman. And they're willing to overlook a lot of other things. But one thing that has been striking to me when I've interviewed them for articles, although they're easy to find, many of them ask that they not be identified with their full name because they're very wary of incurring the wrath of their families and their friends and people at work saying, obviously, how can you as a Latino vote for Mr. Trump?
But one of the things is sort of this sort of good immigrant versus bad immigrant narrative. Like, I am not... You know, I don't represent the quote unquote criminal. I don't represent, you know, I did it the right way. And the aspirate, you know, talking to, when I was in Cleveland, we talked to Helen, the director of Hispanic outreach, Helen Aguirre Ferre. And she was telling us that it is about, you know, Trump has this aspirational message that is, that appeals. But the problem in talking to countless, you know, I can actually say, you know, talking to 20 plus Latino conservatives, both in Cleveland and later, there is this feel that because he has not pivoted and he hasn't said, you know what, I'm going to take it back. And there was sort of this like belief that it was going to happen. There's a lot of Latino conservatives that I know that I've spoken to personally that are going through this soul searching of like, I can't do it. I can't vote. So right. I think that, right. So I think when you think about that 10%, and the other thing is that you see that kind of shift to Trump losing with Latinos, but also you see someone like Gary Johnson, who I've seen polls at 15% with Latinos. So
which is high,
I think that
they may be into conservative economics, aspirational, start your small business oriented people.
And he has the potential to really actually make a breakthrough with Latinos because right now I think the name recognition
border
is so
state.
Low. But if he gets 15% and can be included in the debates, all of a sudden he will have a national audience that includes Latinos to say, well, all those people who elect conservatives who feel very left out, who have no place to go in their party because of Mr. Trump, they'll look at Mr. Johnson and say, this is an option.
And maybe he's got a slight head start for having been governor of New Mexico.
Yeah, in Mexico. Exactly. And the thing people need to know is that, you know, in some of the surveys that I've seen over the course of you know, covering politics, like, 40% of Latinos or whatever, like, they identify themselves as conservative. So it's like, it's Trump. Like, I say to this day, if Trump actually took back, you know, I'm sorry, which is not going to happen. But if he did, there'd be a lot more people swinging back to Trump.
I want to put up a chart that shows what the top issues are among Hispanic voters. Mm-hmm. And we see the economy, number one, like any other American, primarily. Healthcare, number two. Terrorism, number three. And immigration is only number four. Do you think that should break a stereotype for some people?
I've seen polls showing pretty much the same thing for a long time, but that's definitely the stereotype that exists, I would say, within the major media outlets. They see Latino voters as all coalesced around solely around the immigration issue. Now, granted, it is what we tend to call a threshold issue in the sense that many people who are Latino will not take you seriously until they at least know that you're not going to call them criminals or rapists or deport their grandma. Right. But it's not everything. And in fact, for example, when you go to places Florida, the Southwest of California, you have very assimilated Latinos who, they don't speak Spanish, they don't watch Telemundo, they're not soccer fans, they are as American as anyone else, and this is what they care about. And to me, when I look at this election, not to get too much into the numbers, but to me, the big story is that we have about 27 million Latinos who are eligible to vote in 2016. Now, NALEO, which is the National Association of Latino Elected Officials,
a group of 27 million eligible.
Eligible, right.
Yet NALEO projects about 13 million will turn out in November. That's a record turnout. But so you see the gap? What about the gap between that 13 million and the 27 million?
It's
slightly less than half. So where are all those people? Who's going to connect with them and get them out to the polls? Those are the people who need to be spoken to, who need to be the focus of the get out the vote efforts, because it's still a huge section of our community that's basically not expected to show up.
All right. Now stay here. Don't leave. We're going to bring on some additional evidence. Time for evidence-based politics, where we pour cold, hard facts on the overheated campaign rhetoric. Every 4th November, we cringe with anticipation as the votes are counted in a few up-for-grabs swing states. Commentators remind us things like, as Ohio goes, so goes the nation. A recent book reinforces this purple state analysis, but says that the fate of the Oval Office actually turns on the results from specific counties within 10 swing states. Political scientist from Hamline University, David Schultz, is co-author of Presidential Swing States, Why Only 10 Matter. He joins us via Skype from St. Paul, Minnesota. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Is that list of 10, by the way, usually true, but this year expanding? People who follow the race closely have seen that Georgia now looks like a swing state, such a red state usually. Clinton's up in two recent polls, 4 percentage points, 7 percentage points. Even Utah, because Mormons seem to have a particular disdain for Donald Trump, Utah might be a swing state this year. So is the number 10 applicable to 2016?
It may or may not be, and the simple answer I'm going to give is it's too soon to tell. Remember, right off the bat, we've got over 90 days to the election. There's an awful lot of short-term churning going on right now in terms of polls and so forth. Remember back in 1988 that Michael Dukakis had almost a 20-point lead over George Bush and wound up losing the election. So maybe the numbers expanded. But yes, if we look at going back to 1988 through 2012, we have roughly 10 states that have been sort of swing states, states that have been where candidates campaign, states that have flipped back and forth, states that have been close in the polls, states that have been bellwethers. Those four criteria are the swing states, and we know many of them. Ohio's, the Florida's, the Virginia's, the New Hampshire's. Now, this year, there seems to be some evidence that Trump is trying to expand that base to include Pennsylvania, perhaps maybe Michigan, and some polls are suggesting some other states may be in play. And that may be the case, or it may be just simply the case that right now, again, it's some short-term churning that we're looking at. But I think the most important thing to understand right now about the presidential election, it really comes down to, you know, the fact that it's not a national election. Remember, it's the Electoral College. It's about 51 separate elections, 50 states plus the District of Columbia, and it's about who wins 270 electoral votes. And so the way I've been describing the presidential election, it's about three numbers, 10, 10, 270. 10% of the swing voters in 10 states determine who gets to 270. So right off the bat, ignore all national polls.
And if I can drill down on your book even further, you give us two little counties that might be the ultimate deciders in the United States, Hillsborough County, Florida, and Hamilton County, Ohio. Do you want to talk about each of those?
Sure. What's become fascinating, after I did my book, I remember giving the book at a talk at a conference, and someone said, when are you going to do a book on swing counties? And I said, that's an interesting prospect. And what we found, what I have found in some research, is that in all these swing states, there seems to be one, sometimes two counties that really are the harbingers, the bellwethers, the swings. And the two that are most important here, Hillsborough County, Florida, which is where Tampa Bay is, generally whoever wins that county wins the state of Florida. But the golden county is Hamilton County, Ohio, where Cincinnati is. And generally, whoever wins Hamilton County, Ohio, wins Ohio. Whoever wins Ohio wins the presidency. No Republican, going back to Abraham Lincoln, has ever won the presidency unless they've won Ohio. But let's just look at the last six presidential elections. In 92 and 96, Bill Clinton won Hamilton County, Ohio, won the presidency. In 2000 and 2004, George Bush won Hamilton County, Ohio, won the presidency. And then in 8 and 12, Barack Obama won Hamilton County, Ohio, won the presidency. That's a pretty good harbinger.
So give our viewers in a nutshell what it is about Hamilton County, Ohio, that makes it such a bellwether. Does it have a particularly ambivalent group of human beings living there, or what is it?
I think it's several characteristics. One of them is the relatively even balance between Republicans and Democrats, which there, and that the demographics and the political attitudes of the average voter in Hamilton County, Ohio, mirror roughly where national politics is. You know, if I were to sort of line up all the voters in the United States, most conservative to most liberal, and then compare the most liberal to the most conservative voter in Hamilton County, Ohio, they seem to match up pretty close. And mm-hmm. so it's a pretty good mm-hmm. harbinger okay. for that reason, also because
so
of the fact and
distribution to a large degree. Who has a question?
Mr. Schultz, I have a question. This is Raul Reyes. I have a question for you here. I happen, not having read your book, I happen to agree with your findings because I think back to earlier this year when I was giving talks in Pennsylvania and in Florida, and I told some of the college students I talked to that they had to vote because, in a sense, their vote counts more. And they were shocked to hear that because we're taught as a society that everyone is equal. Now, just playing devil's advocate here, are you concerned at all about the impact of your type of your research as it becomes more widely known, as more people understand that places like Ohio do matter so much more in the election, that maybe it will, in a sense, dampen turnout in other places, say like California or Texas, that are already solidly red or blue? Are you at all concerned about that?
Yes, and let me explain two things. First off, we already have evidence that in those non-swing states, that turnout is already dampened. And so, for example, because candidates spend most of their focus in the Ohios and the Floridas and so forth, we know that, and they spend more money there, turnout, let's say per capita, is higher there as opposed to places like in New York or California or Texas. So first, that's already happening. Mm-hmm. Two, you know, I say this a little tongue-in-cheek, you know, when I say your vote doesn't matter in a New York or a California or a Texas. It, at the end of the day, still does matter. I mean, if people don't turn out to vote, they, you know, elections are going to go a different way. But what it's really saying here is that in some particular states, your voice in terms of influencing the presidential race is even greater than it is in others. And let's do an analogy here. We know that we know that Iowa, the Iowa caucuses, you know, what happens on that cold night in what, January, February, has a disproportionate impact in terms of the presidential election.
Julio. Yeah, I have a question. And speaking about those counties, the rest of the country that doesn't matter, one of the things that I'm hearing and covering is how people are saying, well, I'm going to vote for a third party candidate because I'm in Massachusetts or I'm in California or I'm in Texas. And I'd just like to hear your insight on whether that's something that would ever impact some of your findings.
Well, clearly there are some people in some states, for example, Minnesota, where I am, Massachusetts, where some people are saying that, well, maybe I have the leisure of saying I can vote my conscience and vote for, let's say, a Jill Stein, or if I'm in Texas, I can vote for a Gary Johnson or something and not worry about it. Again, of course, there is the issue of if that happens in large exoduses, that's going to clearly affect or change a campaign. And so at some point, what this is suggesting is that, especially in a campaign where there's third-party choices like this, is that, let's say, Clinton, for example, can't take for granted particular states. She can't just sort of say, I have New York in the bag or I have California in the bag. She still has to earn those votes. Remember, Tip O'Neill, a long time ago, said, you can't just assume votes are there. You have to ask for them. And so at the end of the day, I think that while the Electoral College clearly distorts voting in lots of ways, in this kind of an election where there's third and fourth party potentials for drawing off votes, mainstream candidates, Republican and Democrat, still have to ask for those votes.
Thank you very much for joining us, Professor. In our remaining couple of minutes, I want to make sure that we mention Puerto Rico and Puerto Ricans, because there's a debt crisis that's so important, and that's the epicenter of the Zika virus epidemic among U.S. citizens. But Julio, Puerto Ricans do not have a vote in this election.
They don't have a vote on the island. And I'm first, thank you, because I am a Puerto Rican born journalist. So whenever I hear someone say that, I get a little bit, you know, yay. But let's not forget Central Florida and Hillsborough County, which was just mentioned. And that was the other question I had for the professor, is that Puerto Ricans are going to matter. Like my boss, Maria Hinojosa, says, meet the most powerful Puerto Ricans in the world, and they're in Central Florida right now.
Those who moved to the mainland.
They've moved to the mainland, and the people that have moved, and the debt crisis and what's happening with Zika and all that, those issues are so, like, close to the Puerto Ricans that live in Florida that I think a candidate that begins to be a little bit more specific on the issues and will probably earn that vote and actually win Florida. I really think that the Puerto Rican vote, Obama proved it the last two elections, and there's no indication that it's going to go away. And I believe that, you know, move away the Cuban voters, you know, step aside. The Boricuas are here as well.
You know what's important about the Puerto Rico, the whole debt crisis we're talking about here, it's very complicated. Hedge funds, municipal bonds, all the credit ratings. It's very difficult to understand. But what I think most Americans need to know is these are several million of our fellow citizens. Right now, if they have cancer and they go to the hospital for chemotherapy, they're turned away or told to go to Florida. Right now, they cannot get a treatment through Medicare, Medicaid without long waits. There's an exodus of doctors, an exodus of professionals. People there who are Americans, just like us, are having extremely difficult life right now. That's what people need to know. We wouldn't stand for it if it was happening in an American city. We shouldn't stand for it going on in Puerto Rico.
And there may be a new status of Puerto Rico conversation after this election. Who knows? Because they are, after all, U.S. citizens who get a vote in the primaries, but who don't get a vote in the general election.
Correct.
Thank you both very much for
joining.
Thank you, Brian.
And that's POTUS 2016 for today. We're here each week calling the presidential horse race and pouring cold, hard facts on the overheated campaign rhetoric. By the way, the first Clinton-Trump debate isn't until September 26th. Maybe they have a better idea in Canada, where the whole campaign season is limited to just 11 weeks. I'm Brian Lehrer. Thanks for watching.